Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. We're very happy to be here for this historic sitting and first sitting in Pocatello, first sitting in Southeast Idaho, on the occasion of the dedication of the chambers of our good colleague from Pocatello, Judge Smith. It's a pleasure to be here. We've already been welcomed, although it's out of town, very warmly. We're very happy to be here. We have two cases on the calendar, and the first case to be argued is United States versus Alfaro. Counsel ready? Appellant may proceed.
Good morning. May it please the court. In this case, the sole disputed issue of fact for the jury was the question of whether Mr. Alfaro knowingly possessed the two firearms in question. On both of the traffic stops in question, there were more than one person in the car. In the both cases, the weapons were in the rear passenger area of the car. Mr. Alfaro was in the first case driving the car in the front seat. In the second case, he was actually getting into the car, hadn't even completely entered the car yet. So the only, the whole case was about his knowledge of the weapons. In a case like this, it's not uncommon for defense counsel to stipulate, as we did under the Old Chief case, to the fact that, simply the fact, that Mr. Alfaro was a prohibited person. In other words, that he had been previously convicted of a felony that carried a punishment of greater than 1 year. And the whole point, obviously, of such a stipulation is to keep from the jurors other information about the defendant's prior conviction. And we submit that during the jury selection in this case, a member of the veneer stated in the presence of the rest of the veneer that he believed he had seen.
Well, you can try to minimize the jury's exposure to the fact of your client's prior having been a felon, but you can't eliminate it altogether. I mean, it is an element of the crime. The prosecutor can mention it, of course, in his summation, and it is, it's the elephant in the courtroom. You can't really avoid having the jury become aware of the fact that he is somebody who's committed a very serious crime in the past.
Well, the jury knows that he's committed a crime that has a punishment of greater than 1 year. The point of the stipulation, again, is that we keep from the jury any other information, such as the nature of that crime.
Did he actually serve time for it?
Yes, he did.
You think the jury will imagine, gee, he got convicted of a felony, but he was able to walk free?
Well, that's exactly the point, because by the jury knowing that not only had he been convicted of such a crime, that he had actually served time in prison. That's not what you're stipulating to. That's exactly the point of the stipulation, Your Honor.
Well, exactly what did the stipulation say?
That he had been convicted of a crime that carries a punishment of greater than 1 year.
1 year in prison?
Yes.
So the jury is told that he's been convicted of a crime, the punishment for which is more than 1 year in prison. Those words are used.
But they don't know that he was actually in prison.
Well, isn't that a minor point? What else did the judge do to minimize the problem that
actually
was created when
Your
the
Honor,
juror said?
I stand corrected. He stipulated that at all relevant times he was a prohibited person and that he had previously been convicted of a crime punishable by imprisonment for more than 1 year. That was the stipulation.
Punishable by
more than 1 year.
And what does it add for the prospective juror to have said, I spend some time occasionally through my church at the prison. I'm just curious as to whether I have seen him at the prison before because he looks familiar to me.
Well, we would contend that that undermines the whole purpose of the of our stipulation, in that they now have more information than they would have had otherwise.
I know I've seen him at prison. He said, I'm just curious as to whether I've seen him.
Well,
that juror was excused.
He was excused for cause, yes.
And what did the judge do to minimize the possible impact of what that prospective juror had said?
Well, he obviously it was at sidebar, the conversations with this juror concerning his removal for cause. And then there was there were a series of instructions that were given, obviously.
And what were the instructions?
Well, that they were only to consider the case based on the evidence that was before them.
And doesn't that usually cure any possible problem?
Well, I would submit that, in this case, it did not.
And how do we know that?
Well, I would submit, as I have in the brief, that it's analogous to wearing prison garb or being required to wear prison garb in front of the jury, because they now know that he's done something. He's not just a prohibited person, that he's actually been in prison.
Well, but they don't really know that he was in prison. There was just a question asked. Isn't that true?
Well.
And then there was a sidebar. And then didn't you agree with the judge that he shouldn't get right on that and give an instruction at the time, but that one should give general instructions which would cure the problem? I mean, I got the idea that his counsel was also not excited that the judge would say something right at the time in order to try to do something with it.
Well,
and yet he gave plenty of good instruction about it. Would you deny that he didn't give enough good instruction about don't get prejudiced, don't be prejudiced by anything that's been said here, you're supposed to do this on the evidence, all of that?
Well, I would submit to respond to that, Your Honor, that of course he gave the appropriate curative instruction. However, I don't think that cures or ameliorates the danger, the possibility of prejudice here. And what it does is it undermines the presumption of innocence. This man was not stipulating to anything other than that he wasn't legally allowed to have a gun. That's all he was stipulating to. And you're correct. I was trial counsel, and I didn't want the court to take it up immediately because I thought it would only draw more attention to it. But then again, Your Honor, the jury hears this, the veneer hears this statement. There's a series of sidebars, and then later on this juror is called up and is mysteriously removed from the rest of them. And so they're only left to speculate, well, gee, he must have known that this guy was in prison. I mean, I think the cat's out of the bag. The judge even said as much. He used that phrase. He said, well, I guess the cat's out of the bag. Now, I think it's instructive to hear the court's comments. It's at page 26 of the excerpts of record when he denies the motion for a new veneer panel. If this had been any other charge but this, you would have got it. One of the elements of the case is a prior felony conviction. I can't see the prejudice in this. Well, the only element for the only disputed fact for the jury to find was whether or not he knowingly possessed these guns.
Part of one of the issues that arises from what you just said is the level of deference that we give to the trial judge. We're an appellate court. We're not there. We can't see this. We didn't hear it. And so under certain circumstances, we give quite a lot of latitude to a trial court. What's the standard of review we use on this in determining whether the judge made a mistake or not?
Well, Your Honor, voir dire procedures, according to the Howell case, are reviewed for an abuse of discretion. However, there's another case that says this court, although this court reviews the district court's voir dire for abuse of discretion, whether a defendant was deprived of a fair trial by the nature of the voir dire is a legal question reviewed de novo.
But so, don't we also have a case, U.S. v. Martinez, that suggests that the decision regarding the bias of a veneerman is manifest error or abuse of discretion? Isn't that what we say in U.S. v. Martinez?
Yes, Your Honor, but I'm not quite sure how that squares with the Milner case.
And if error, then what is your burden? Even if that were error, what is your burden at that point under our standard of review?
Well, I would say it's
must there not be something show that it was harmless beyond a reasonable doubt, and isn't that the state's burden at that point, or the government's?
Yes.
Okay, so we're really looking at then if it's prejudice, and then after that, even if prejudice, was it harmless beyond a reasonable doubt?
That's correct, and I just also point out that this is, we're talking about a fundamental right here to a fair trial, the presumption of innocence.
So you think it's structural error?
I'm not going to go that far, but I think it's a fundamental error.
Doesn't Estelle say there's no per se rule regarding whether someone has been deprived of his right to a fair trial? And that being the case, one time when it is not such a deprivation, it's the facts that we look at in this particular case?
And I urge you to look at the facts, Your Honor. And again, I'm almost out of time, but the point is, the only issue in the case was whether this man knowingly possessed those weapons. Thank you.
We'll hear from the government.
May it please the court. My name is Christian Nascar. I represent the United States. The only possible inference that the jury panel could take by the unexpected statement of the Spinnerman boils down to they could think that the defendant may have been in prison. It was an unequivocal statement, or an equivocal statement, by the jury member who said that he may have recognized the defendant from his volunteering in prison. The reason why there is no prejudice for the panel to have heard that is exactly the same inference that the panel could take from the defendant's own stipulation.
Well, not quite. I mean, he stipulates that he pled guilty to a crime punishable by a year, or maybe a year and a day, I forget exactly, but it was a year. And the jury could have imagined the way that was phrased is that the crime was punishable by a year or more in prison, but he got probation.
That's true. But they also could have thought he may have been in prison. I would argue that most people sitting on the panel would say he may have, he may not have. We know for a fact that he is stipulating that he was convicted of a crime punishable by more than 1 year in prison. Now, they definitely don't.
But if it makes a difference to them whether he actually served time in prison or not, it may not make a difference. But let's say it does make a difference to them whether he's one of those guys who actually spent time in prison as opposed to somebody that the judge the last time around let off easy, you know, for whatever reason. This would be a piece of evidence that would make him think, he probably actually did get serious time for that crime.
And I could see your point. There's, you know, they hear it both from the stipulation and from the inference from the Vanierman. But that's not the end of the argument. I mean,
well, aren't you asking us to assume that they didn't pay any attention to the instructions not to consider this?
Well, exactly. I'm not. But first you have to assess the risk of the statement. And then looking at how that risk is essentially the same as his own stipulation, you next move to what the district court did to obviate the potential prejudice. And the district court did exactly what he was supposed to do in this case. Looking at supplemental excerpts of records on page 9, he first instructs the panel on the presumption of innocence. When the Vanierman on the supplemental excerpts of record 44 makes his statement, he does not take it up immediately. In fact, he waits until there's another panelist who has to come before the court for a sidebar. At that point, he brings him up outside the presence of the jury. He questions him regarding what he actually does or does not know regarding the defendant's incarceration. And then he excuses him for cause. And then again, he goes back on supplemental of excerpts of record, page 99, where he talks about the prior stipulation and the sole issue of this trial was possession. And he didn't highlight the fact. It was fortuitous for the district court because he could essentially get to the presumption of innocence and the issue on whether he was previously incarcerated or not, address the elephant in the room without actually mentioning the statement made by the Vanierman.
How many potential jurors were there in the room when this person popped up and said, I think I recognize this guy from my visits to prison? How many jurors were in the room?
The entire panel was there.
About how many was that?
Speaking from memory, I would venture to guess somewhere in the neighborhood of 40.
40? How hard is it just to say, you're all gone, let's get another 40?
Well,
it's pretty serious when somebody pops up and says, I think I recognize this guy from prison. I recognize this is a different kind of a case, and even the judge said that. Ordinarily, you'd win and we'd start all over again. Well, but how hard was it to start all over again?
Well, it wouldn't be that hard. I mean, obviously, there would be the inconvenience for the jurors who have a right to serve on a trial and were there and willing to answer questions. And
why wouldn't that be the appropriate exercise of discretion, just to eliminate any possibility at all of an unfair trial for this defendant?
Well, you can look at other cases that deal with this type of prejudice. And I think the district court has the ability and the duty to weigh the risks of that prejudice. And the district court correctly assumed that that risk was very slight. And it's one that can be cured by curative instructions. And so
this was a Boise case?
It was. Okay. And so the district court can look at, is this a risk? And he kind of sets out his thinking and saying, if this was any other type of case.
Because this is serious stuff when a potential juror pops up and says something like that.
It's very serious, but the district court did exactly what it is required to do. And when you look at
Let me ask you this. Let's say this had not happened. Assume this incident had not happened. And the plaintiff stipulates to his status as he stipulates. What would you have been entitled to say in your summation, or what reference would you have been entitled to make as part of the government's case to the fact of his conviction or incarceration or anything like that?
Your Honor, I would be bound by the stipulation that the defendant made, which was that he had previously been convicted of a crime punishable by more than 1 year in prison. I would not be able to go into and say that you could speculate that he was incarcerated.
But you could mention that the stipulation, your summation.
Yes, Your Honor.
Well, I don't think you could, because the judge told the jury, well, the jury must compartmentalize this and put aside that testimony or that evidence that the defendant had a prior felony conviction and focus solely upon the question of whether the defendant possessed a firearm. So how could you, in summation, go against that and say the guy had been convicted of a crime?
I guess I would be able to say that going through the elements of the crime, I would simply be able to say this element of whether he had been previously convicted has been stipulated to. And so there wouldn't be any extensive argument regarding that. But I believe I would be able to mention the fact that as to one of the elements that the government has to prove, there is a stipulation. Maybe it would be best to refer to the district court and remind them that the district court made the following stipulation word for word. I don't believe that there would be any reason to go into any more depth regarding that stipulation.
So if this is error, counsel, what evidence do I have in this record that it is harmless beyond a reasonable doubt? Because I think that's your burden.
Well, when you look at what the jury ultimately did, they acquitted Mr. Alfaro on count two. Count two was possession of an SKS rifle that was found in a car that he was the driver of. It was also the same SKS that he was photographed holding. And so you have evidence that this jury was able to compartmentalize and put aside the fact that he had previously been convicted and focus solely on the issue at hand, which was, did he possess the firearm? Otherwise, they would not have acquitted. There was only one issue before them. And
you know, speaking personally, that kind of an argument doesn't impress me, because I tried cases for 23 years, and you don't know what a jury did or why. I mean, what goes on behind closed doors? Sometimes when you talk to the jurors, you come away scratching your head. You just don't know what they did and why. I mean, it may have been a compromise verdict. Who knows?
True. But on an issue.
Entitled to one gun.
I'm sorry?
Maybe they thought he was entitled to one gun.
I mean, you can tell anecdotal stories all day long, but One of my friends tried a case charging somebody with having a sawed-off shotgun. And it was an open-and-shut case. It went to the jury, and the jury acquitted the defendant. And afterwards, the prosecutor asked the jury, well, why'd you quit the guy? And the juror said, well, what was the big deal about having a broken shotgun? They thought that sawed off meant it was broken. I mean, you don't have any idea what
the... And I'll concede, I have no basis to know why they acquitted on that. Although we do know that there was one issue, and that was...
To the grain of salt, what Judge Trott says, prosecutors always think it's open and shut.
Right.
I won't disagree with that. As far as the harmless error, when you look at the court's curative instructions... And when you contrast what happened here with other cases, such as Milner, where you have much greater inappropriate comments made before the court, but nonetheless, the Ninth Circuit has found that curative instructions fix the problem. The prejudice in this case is so slight, especially when compared to the stipulation by the defendant, that his fair trial...
Was there overwhelming evidence?
Well, I just told you they acquitted on one count, so I don't know if I can tell you.
Well,
yes, of course.
That's what I
thought. There was overwhelming evidence, Your Honor. There was photographs of the defendant holding firearms. And in a case where the sole issue was, did he possess those firearms, I would argue that there was overwhelming evidence.
Who authenticated the photograph?
There was a friend of the defendant who was present when the photograph was taken, and she explained how the defendant handed her the SKS rifle so she could be photographed with the firearm.
Was she a gang member, too?
She was. That was not part of the record in front of the jury, though.
Very credible witness.
Yes. I'm just about out of time. If there's no further
questions... Yes, it's hard to get bishops to testify. if they just don't have the facts.
Right. If there's no further questions, I would ask this court to affirm the district court. Thank you.
Thank you. You were out of time, but if you would like to take a minute for a rebuttal, you may do so. The sentencing issue was not argued, and therefore I would ask you not to go into that if you're going to go limited to this issue because the government didn't get a chance to argue.
Thank you. I simply want to conclude by saying that it is impossible to know how the jury would have evaluated this information and what effect it had on their deliberations.
But the problem comes, counsel, that by the very instructions that one would suggest that maybe this was a tough situation, Judge Windmill didn't stop at the first about the defendant being presumed innocent. He said to the jury, you are instructed that the defendant had a prior felony conviction, but that should not be a factor in your decision making. That's exactly what he said.
Well, Judge, I mean, but the jury heard way more than that. They heard more
we're
than
we're to assume they don't listen to the judge?
Well, I would never say that, of course.
You don't think they'd infer that the juror saw him in prison, he was one of the guards, for example?
Well, I'm sorry, I didn't understand your question, Judge.
All he said is, juror, I might have seen him in prison. He could have been one of the guards. He could have been one of the chaplains. He could have been one of the orderlies. I mean, I don't know what the...
Well, that would have
I mean, prison staff.
That would have certainly been featured in the defense case if that were true, Judge.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Case just arguable stands submitted. Very